Good evening all. Few of the participants had expressed their inability to attend morning session. So we have requested Kusum to summarize morning session of the speaker, Mrs. Divya from Deloitte. I would like to introduce Kusum to all of you. Kusum is a chartered accountant having over 20 years of experience in the field of tax, audit, legal and regulatory matters. She is a founder director of Blue Square Management Consultants. Her special interest is towards GST. Their firm focuses on advising tax and regulatory matters and assisting with representation on tax matters. Yes, her profile is quite big. Yes, I want to make it short and over to you, Kusum.
Sure. Thank you very much, Shilpa, for the introduction. And you know, I have been assigned this job of summarizing Divya Tiwari's session. I must say that she has done a great job in putting such a complex thing in about one and a half hours of time. And I don't know whether I will be able to do the same justice, but I will try my level best to do this. So may I request Ravindranath or Shilpa to actually run the slides if it is possible for them, so that I can then continue to talk about it, or I can actually talk without the slides also. I am quite good to go, so to say.
I will share the slides because people who have not participated will get an idea about that.
Great.
You can continue. I'll just take out on that.
Yeah, so basically, Divya started off this morning by stating that ESOP is a derivative. It is a call option derivative. Why it is a derivative? It is because ESOP value, it depends on the underlying share value of the company. Now, when options are issued to an employee or to the employees in general, the employees will evaluate the value of the stock option based on the movement of the share price of the company. So the underlying is the stock price of the company, and therefore the financial instrument, which is the call option or the derivative instrument, is what is offered by the company to the employees. Now, stock option, it is a right of the employee to buy the share of the company at a particular price over a period of time, which is agreed in terms of an employee stock option agreement. So till such time the stock options are, options are issued, they do not become the shareholders. They only become the shareholders once they exercise the option and, they fulfill the requirements, whether, again, we'll come, I will be talking about it, whether it is actually, how those stock options are settled, whether it is cash-based or equity-based. Only when that settlement happens, then they either become the shareholders of the company or they just gain from the options that they have. Now, the ESOPs, it can act, as I was mentioning, it can be either cash settled or equity settled. If it is, when I say equity settled, it means to say that the differential will be settled by shares. If it is cash settled, it means that the differential will be settled by cash. And again, she also mentioned about AS 102. Now, most of us are aware that AS 102 or the Ind AS standards have become applicable from FY 17-18 onwards. So I just spoke about the first slide, what is a stock option and what is equity settled and cash settled. Now, if it is cash settled, it means to say that the company has to assess the payout every single time they are making the payments. Meaning to say that the company will have to undertake valuations at every reporting period in case it is the terms of the agreement says that it has to be cash settled. Again, if it is equity settled, it means to say that it only has to be done once. Maybe it has to be done only on the grant date. And it was also mentioned that there is absolutely no difference in the valuation of these two variants, whether it is cash settled or whether it is equity settled. The significance is only from an accounting point of view, and you know, as I just now mentioned, if it is equity settled, you do valuation once. If it is cash settled, valuation is done at every reporting period. Again, she also mentioned that you know, there can be you know, varieties of you know, stock options. They can be called as stock appreciation rights or phantom stock. What are stock appreciation rights? It means to say that it is, you know, it is a type of an benefit that is given to the employees. It is always cash settled. When I say it is cash settled, it means to say that employees will participate only if there is an upward movement in the stock price, and therefore it will become a liability for the company. And she also spoke about phantom stocks. And she, what is phantom stock? It is actually, it is, you know, it is also another type where it is cash settled. It is normally given to the senior leadership. There is no voting rights. They never become the shareholders of the company. It and you know, phantom stocks are nothing but you know, it is also called as hypothetical stocks or synthetic stocks. So irrespective of whatever may be the variant, whether it is an ESOP or whether it is a SAR or whether it is phantom stock, the valuation is similar. Maybe we can just move to the next slide. So she also told about, you know, the Black-Scholes model. And you know, that what are the types of the option pricing models that are very popular. It is BSM, that is Black-Scholes model, and then there is binomial and Monte Carlo model. Depending on the, as and when the options are exercised, the relevant model is used. Meaning to say, the Black-Scholes model is used when you know, when the options are exercised at one point in time, that is at you know, as you know, as on the maturity date, Black-Scholes model is used. And if it if it can be exercised any time, you know, at on any date up to the maturity date, then you know, either the binomial option pricing model is used or the Monte Carlo simulation model is used. So coming back this to Black-Scholes model, it is the most basic option pricing model. It is used when option only when the options have to be valued where the exercise is at maturity. Whereas in a binomial tree model, it has the option value will be determined at every interval, assuming that it is the assumption is that the options are exercised at any at different points in time before maturity. So coming, she went on to explain the Black-Scholes model. In again, Black-Scholes model, basically there are two components to be valued. One is the intrinsic value and the time value. There was also an example that was given. You know, what is intrinsic value? Intrinsic value is nothing but the difference between the strike price and the market price. Say, for example, the market price is at 80 and the strike price or the offer price is at 70. Then positive difference. That means to say it is a buy call option. That means to say it is in the money. So again, in a Black-Scholes model, it is important that only positive differences are considered and no negative differences are considered. As I said, there are two components in the Black-Scholes model. Assuming that the Black-Scholes model comes up with a number after all the various you know, parameters are input. You know, let us say, for example, the number that we get is, say, 15 rupees. So if that be the case, considering the example that we are speaking about, 10 rupees is the intrinsic value and the balance 5 rupees is the time value of the money. Okay, so then moving on to the next slide. She also spoke about you know, binomial options. What is binomial? Binomial means there are two outcomes. You know, let us again coming to that example. Let us say the today's price is 70 rupees, and it can, you know, there can be two options. One, either the option that it can be higher, or or it can be lower. And the option is given to an employee to exercise at any point of time before maturity. Now, as and when binomial option pricing is chosen by the valuer will have to decide whether he has to look at the movement of the share price on a daily basis or a weekly basis or on a quarterly basis, half yearly or yearly basis, as there is no hard and fast rule that is prescribed. The thumb rule is that the more number of, the more closer the movement is, the better would be the pricing. So what it also means to say that at every node, there exists a value, and the highest node amongst all the probabilities will be discounted to the present value to arrive at the binomial option value. Now, what is a trinomial model? In trinomial model, there is another dimension that is added. There can be an upward movement, there can be a downward movement, or it can be stable. So that means to say that there are three outcomes. So it also means to say that there is one more level of complexity that is added. And that means to say that because of this, and again, it also depends on the number of iteration that the valuer will choose. Again, the more number of iterations, the closer will be the value. So at the end of the day, there is also an element of volatility that is being when we are using a binomial or a trinomial option model. So I must also say that previously it was intrinsic value was sufficient, that is the difference between the spot price and the strike price. Now after Ind AS has come, not only that, the intrinsic value is totally ruled out. Not only the importance has to be given to the intrinsic value, even the time value of, the options should also be incorporated in the pricing, and therefore the requirement for valuation. Now coming to the next, which is the Monte Carlo simulation. So what is Monte Carlo simulation? It means to say that it is, this model is used to model the probability of different outcomes in a process that is future based. So, in a Monte Carlo simulation, there can be even, from 500 or 1,000 iterations, even up to 1 lakh iterations can be used. What it also means to say that if there are more number of iterations that are used, the result could be a little more accurate. No doubt Monte Carlo simulation is voluminous to calculate, but what it means that it takes the average of all the possibilities, and it also it works on a theory of random numbers, and it throws up the random numbers, and the thumb rule is that the average numbers, whatever is the outcome of all the results, will average out and it will actually converge. Aspect is the asset will actually grow at a risk-free rate. There will be a volatility that will actually lead to deviation in the pricing of the asset. Again, we have discussed the intrinsic value and the time value of the options. Maybe we can go to the next slide. She also spoke about the sensitivity of input parameters. What one other aspect that she actually spoke about, in Monte Carlo simulation is when is it actually used? And she spoke about a concept called TSR, which is total stock returns. What it actually means is that it is, and she also said that, she has seen about 3 instances in the past 1.5 years where TSR has been used by various companies. What is TSR? It is actually an incentive plan. It is based on, it is based on various parameters. There can be the options that are issued to the employees. It can be, usually it is time-based, which is a plain vanilla model. But there can be certain other, aspects that can get embedded, which is like, where vesting is contingent upon an event. Say, for example, an IPO. The vesting will happen only if the company goes public. or maybe you know, if it reaches a particular turnover, or it reaches, you know, it achieves a particular probability. When there are you know, various parameters like these which are built in, then you know, Monte Carlo simulation is used. And you know, speaking about TSR, she said that, you know, it is based on an incentive plan, where one feature of correlation is, you know, it is actually identifying the value of the correlation, meaning to say that, you know, multiple parameters can be incorporated in, it can be correlated and incorporated in a Monte Carlo simulation. The other aspect she also mentioned was the GSEC rate that we are using in our, you know, risk-free rate that we are using in our valuation, you know, simulations or models. It need not necessarily be the correct one, because, you know, that also comes with a risk. What you know, as Deloitte, what they are using is, you know, from Clearing Corporation of India Limited, CCIL, there is a zero coupon yield curve rate that CCIL provides. So that is a better bet than the risk-free rate that we normally are using, which is the 10-year bond rate. So these are some of the aspects that she covered this morning. And of course, she also kind of spoke about certain, I know she clarified on various questions that were raised by the participants as to, you know, what is it that they usually use, whether they use, you know, Black-Scholes model, or whether they use binomial option pricing. And she said that, yeah, depending on the client and depending on the requirements, I think, you know, the models are used. And of course, she also mentioned that, you know, a binomial or a trinomial option pricing model, you know, calls for a higher a fee from the client, because it is a more complex model than a Black-Scholes model, because it is a plain vanilla formula based model. There were certain other things also that were spoken about, which is, you know, she spoke about something called trading of options, or trading based on the volatility of the options. And of course, you know, it is not done much in India, but that is what is actually done internationally. I think this is what she basically spoke. You know, if I have actually missed out on something which is critical, maybe some any other participant can actually add, you know, so that it makes it more complete.
Kusum, it was really a very good revision for all of us. You know, today morning, whatever we have learned from Divya in 1.5 hours, 2 hours, you have very beautifully summarized it. And that in a very short time. By the time I could give the recording to you, it was already 2 o'clock. It was so nice of you to have accepted our request to summarize it. Thank you so much on behalf of all of us. Thank you so much.